From Bryant Denny Stadium in Tuscaloosa, the top-ranked Alabama Crimson Tide plays host to the Chattanooga Mocs. Welcome to the Capstone and Crimson Tide pay-per-view, along with former Bama quarterback Tyler Watts. I'm Chris Stewart. Glad to have you with us. Senior Day, always special.
It's always fun. The fans really enjoy this, along with the players, as each of the players individually gets acknowledged and that they get to show their appreciation not only for what they've done this season, but also their entire career.
Might take a while not to run through the seniors, but through their accomplishments. They have been tremendous throughout their careers. Certainly, number 10 among the crowd favorites, A.J. McCarron, playing his final game here at home. Unbelievable resume, not just in the past, but this season as well.
It's been fun to watch him develop over his entire career, and as he's taken leadership every single year and stepped it up just a notch, the numbers that he's been able to put up this season throughout his career have been amazing.
The offense has been very good. The defense always exceptional under Nick Saban. Great linebackers like C.J. Mosley among the reasons why.
Another player that as soon as he stepped on campus made an impact immediately, and it's been fun to watch him develop as he moved from the outside inside, continue to clog up the running lanes, but also he doesn't come off the field in passing situations because of his ability to run with anybody out there on the field.
Now, Chattanooga's had a great season as well at the FCS level. They've guaranteed themselves at least a share of the Southern Conference Championship. One of the major reasons why, the play of their quarterback in Jacob Huseman. He may be limited today, though, because of an injury, and that's why the guy he normally throws passes to, Terrell Robinson, could get snaps at quarterback.
And Terrell Robinson has had experience. 2 years ago versus Elon, he had career-high numbers in both rushing and passing, so a guy with some experience who can give some challenging looks to Alabama.
It's the final home game of the regular season for the Crimson Tide. Alabama and Chattanooga, starting lineups and the kick when we come back here on Crimson Tide pay-per-view. Dark, dreary, a little bit damp, but we're ready to play football in Tuscaloosa as we welcome you back to Bryant-Denny Stadium. I'm Chris Stewart along with Tyler Watts, and we welcome in the third member of our crew, Mick Gillespie.
All right, thanks a lot, Chris. You remember it was 2010 on Senior Day that Alabama lost to Auburn. This class was freshmen. They had that never-again mentality. They adopted the entire team, and they were led by A.J. McCarron. 15 seniors today are having their last contest here at home, and A.J. McCarron has led the way. This team's only lost twice, but they've won two national championships since that loss. A.J. McCarron... 35 wins for McCarron right now. That matches Jay Barker with the most for a starting quarterback in school history. And his 496 winning percentage, well, that's tops at Alabama and also in the SEC. Back to you guys.
Thank you so much, Mick. He'll handle our Cooks Pest Control sideline reports today. And again, Tyler, a lot of emotions for these players right now. Nick Saban always preaches a faceless opponent, so they're not worried about the fact that it's Chattanooga or whoever they're facing, but these guys, hard to put out of their minds that this is the last time they will go through a ball game here.
And I'm sure over the course of this game, that exact thought will enter their mind at various times out there on the field as they're up looking around during a commercial break or something, just kind of soaking it in. One last opportunity here to play in front of this home crowd.
Do you think about that when you're putting the uniform on the last time in the locker room?
I think you do. I think everybody does it a little bit different. I know I did. I was like, it's the last time I'm going to be tying my shoes here. Last time I'm putting my pants on. And it wasn't. I've put my pants on plenty of times since then. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I'll be here all week.
Great start to the ball game here. Gade Foster, one of those seniors. There is Nick Saban. Of course, he had the national championship at LSU before making his way to Tuscaloosa. One stop in between in Miami with the Dolphins, but an incredible run. Three national championships in the last 4 years. Again, four for his coaching career, and the Tide with the inside track at another, with obviously work to be done. Part of that work just moments away from getting started, as the Tide will be taking on the Chattanooga Mocs with Cade Foster to kick for Alabama. If the ball will stay on the tee, the wind obviously a little bit of a factor. We saw early forecast, Tyler, that said wind gusts 20 to 25 miles per hour potentially. I don't think it's quite that high, but it's still a little bit of a factor, even down at field level, obviously.
Yeah, because of the shape of the bowl here, it's a swirling wind as well, especially down there.
Marquise Green, number 21 among the deep men, along with C.J. Board. After the hold from Cyrus Jones, the kick will be fielded at the 5-yard line. And a very nice return for Marquise Green, who gets the ball across the 25, a 21-yard return for Green, and good starting field position for the Mocs of Chattanooga. Their head coach, Russ Huseman, who has done a wonderful job. Again, they are assured of a share, at least, of the Southern Conference Championship. As we see, Terrell Robinson is indeed coming out, Tyler, to get the start at quarterback, and that brings a little bit different element to things for Chattanooga, even though Huseman has been awfully good this year. They go on the handoff, and Green gets strung out on the play. Ha-ha, Clinton Dix making the stop for the Crimson Tide, a loss of a couple on the play.
And we're going to see variations of this particular play over and over the course of the day. It's just a little toss up the middle. It's considered a pass, but no more than really just a handoff. But Terrell Robinson has some game experience. He's not the main trigger guy, but he's still capable of doing some things for this Chattanooga team.
Very talented athlete, 6'3", 200 pounds, out of South Pittsburgh, Tennessee, on second and 11. They're going to straight handoff, and running room in short supply for Marquise Green. Jeffrey Pagan leading the stop for this Alabama defense, which has been one of the best in America, obviously, since Nick Saban's arrival. But again, this year, allowing just 10 points per game from the opposition, 102 total all season long. And boy, on the ground, only allowing 3 yards per carry. So now on third down and 9. Nowhere to go after a gain of perhaps 2 yards. And the Mocs will have to punt it away. Not a shock that C.J. Mosley is right in the middle of all that for the Crimson Tide, the senior out of Theodore, Alabama.
Geno Smith also from that cornerback position, red rant run, forced everything inside and held containment there on the perimeter.
We were talking among ourselves about some keys to the game, and for Chattanooga, find a way to get this to the second half. There have been so many teams in the Southeastern Conference that have been out of the contest by halftime. So finding a way, don't make mistakes, play smart, see what happens. Something that they will have on their minds, as there was a mistake by Alabama. Christian Jones didn't really go after that one as aggressively as Nick Saban would like, and the Mocs may have an early break, and they do. They'll come out with a football as Jones didn't field it cleanly. It looked like he was trying to make up his mind what he really wanted to do there.
How many times this season have we seen him catch one off a short hop and save about 10 to 15 yards and an extra, hidden yardage there? This one takes a little short hop, a little goofy hop on him there, and he's fighting for it at the bottom, but mental mistake, trying to save yardage there, and ended up costing the ball.
Samaje Kendall falling on the football, winning that battle. And so Chattanooga with the first break. That's the fifth turnover in the last 4-plus quarters for this Alabama football team, as they'll take over from the 34. They'll swing it out quickly to Green and get bumped out of bounds after a gain of about 3. The Chattanooga starting lineup looking like this across the front. Patrick Sutton, former walk-on, starting every game of his career for the Mocs. Tight end, big part of what they do offensively. Fessel Shafat, number 88. So they pick up 3 yards on first down. The Mocs at the Alabama 31. Not what the Tide fans were expecting early on. But again, this is an 8-3 ball club. Chattanooga as Robinson keeps it himself and sets up a third down and about two and a half. So we check, take a look at the Alabama defense. Ed Stinson has never missed a ball game. He's never missed a practice due to injury. He has been a mainstay along the defensive front for Nick Saban throughout his Alabama career. Of course, the linebacking core, awfully good as well, led by Mosley and Trey DePriest. Very, very talented. Also, Maurice Smith getting the start at one corner. Deion Blue, because of an ankle, because of a toe injury that's been nagging, gets the start there today. And we will see Huseman come in at quarterback. We knew that he would be available. Didn't know how much we would see. And it was second in the Southern Conference in completion percentage. They try to go with a reverse, and Alabama reads it perfectly. Mosley there to him in the ball carrier. Xavier Borchotti.
Chattanooga here. I think that this play call also kind of evident of their wanting to protect Huseman. Terrell Robinson's helmet came off on the prior play, therefore he had to come out of the ball game. That's why we're seeing Huseman here, but it looks like they're trying to protect him as well.
They will keep Huseman in the game as they'll go for it on fourth down at about five. So a great opportunity for Chattanooga. If you're just tuning in, Bama fumbling the punt. Christian Jones mishandling it after the ball actually had bounced in front of him. Tried to pick it up and couldn't gain the handle. Hubert Owens, our referee, leading this SEC crew. As the Mox will have fourth and five once play resumes. With you here on Crimson Tide pay-per-view as Chattanooga gets an early break. Opportunity to take advantage of it here, but fourth down and five, what are you looking for from the box?
Well, that'd be a 39, 40, 41-yard field goal. That would be longer. That'd be 51, wouldn't it?
Are points 30? That important right no. here for them? Is it about touchdown? Because, again, this is, in some sense, this is like a bowl game for Chattanooga. They could be in the FCS playoffs next week.
That's the key.
But they could kind of, they can't throw all caution to the wind
right.
in terms of personnel, but in terms of strategy, you can do that, can't you, if you're Russ Huseman?
I think so. But every single year in the NFL, I'm just going to take the NFL, you'll see teams that have clinched in a playoff berth rest their guys the last week or so and then get knocked out the first round. It's almost like it's counterproductive to not let your guys get in there and fight, get in a good rhythm. And I think you go for it. I don't think that you're right. Points don't mean anything right now. It's about scoring touchdowns. It's about getting your guys' confidence up. And I don't think you have anything to lose here.
Russ Huseman, the head coach of the Mox, as we said. Fifth season and trying to come into Tuscaloosa, Alabama, and pull off what would be the largest upset in quite a while. Although I will say the Mox are not the biggest underdog that has come into Bryant-Denny this season. Again, they've had a wonderful year, but they're going to go with Terrell Robinson at quarterback, operating from the gun. Plenty of time to throw. A flag has come in. Now he'll unload it, and that's going to be picked off. Trey DePriest with the interception. And Alabama will either have the ball there. So DePriest gets the pick. But Bama loses a few yards in the process.
They'll take it. I'm sure these guys watched the Georgia game last week. You don't pass up an opportunity to intercept the ball. And you couldn't help but catch. That's great defensive play, though. A little wheel route right there. Trey DePriest staying right in that back pocket. Turned around, watched the eyes right at the last second. One-handed catch as well, Chris.
Awfully nice play. Kenyon Drake getting the start for Alabama. T.J. Yeldon not likely to go. He has been battling a little bit of an ankle sprain. And with some, shall we say, bigger games still to come for Alabama. Saban not wanting to risk the injury, but not much going there, regardless of whether it's number four, number 17, or whoever gets the call. He got a block up front, and Chattanooga doing a great job of snuffing that one out. Now the Tide will go with Jones, Norwood, and Amari Cooper to the top of your picture. Straight is alongside A.J. McCarron. The senior from Mobile has his pass deflected. A great job there by Wes Dothard, the linebacker. So take a look at the starting lineup there. The offensive front, the Quanjo brothers on the left side, Anthony Steen among the seniors, recognized before the game at guard. Norwood, a great career. O.J. Howard also starting in place of Brian Vogler at tight end. Vogler also with an ankle injury a week ago. Coach Saban somewhat cautionary with those injuries. Third and nine now for Alabama. As McCarron steps up, throws, has a man, catches made. That's Norwood at midfield in a foot race. They'll bring him down just shy of the 30-yard line and tack on a few more as a flag comes in, likely to be a face mask. And that is a nice third down conversion for Alabama. 52 yards on the play for the Crimson Tide.
Personal foul, face mask, defense number 20. 15 yards added to the end of the run. First down.
How was he so open?
You know, production in the first quarter has really plagued Alabama the last 2 weeks here, but just a broken down play. Everyone thinks he scrambled. Therefore, you get the linebackers to come up and creates a huge void that Norwood is eventually going to find anywhere in the little square end route. But good protection up front is what you want to see out of the Alabama offense.
So Drake gets the nod here, spins away from one tackler, but gets brought down by the second. Keontae Davis, defensive lineman, making that hit. Alabama now with second and six. Tide has been very good in the red zone. 41 trips coming into the ball game. They have scored touchdowns on 28 of those appearances.
And not the strength of Chattanooga either.
Drake bouncing it to the outside. Makes another man miss, and he will score. Touchdown, Alabama, Kenyon Drake. 13-yard touchdown run, and Alabama gets on the board first.
Well, it started off with a third and nine, and that was a scary situation. But after the long completion to Kevin Norwood, nice response by the Alabama offense on their opening possession.
Cade Foster, the senior, on to try the extra point. 46 of 46 on the year. And he knocks that one through as well. So the Tide with a 7-0 lead, 8:57 to go here in the opening quarter from Bryant-Denny Stadium. Kenyon Drake's 13-yard touchdown run puts Bama on the board first. Shaky start. Tyler starts to look like Alabama.
Yeah, that was a little scary situation there, wasn't it? All of a sudden you're thinking, oh great, here we go, we're flat again. And bless our hearts, we're all thinking about next week already for whatever reason. Don't need to do that. But a great job right here by the offensive line. Two consecutive runs. You only pick up four or five there by Kenyon Drake there on first down, but then immediately go back to it. He bounced it to the outside, got a great block by Kenny Bell in the perimeter, was able to get in, break a tackle, and get in for a score.
And Chattanooga's got to be frustrated. They have done a pretty nice job defensively, but the two big plays, the Norwood pass covering 52 yards on the throw and catch and run, and then after a couple of stops inside the red zone, now you see the touchdown run.
Yeah, and here's that blocking scheme that I was talking about. Kelly does a good job getting up to the second level. Norwood and Kenny Bell there on the perimeter, able to get him in a one-on-one situation. If you're a running back, if you have one-on-one situation with a safety, that's as good as it's ever going to get. You got to make that guy miss. Kenyon Drake did exactly that.
Kenny Bell, as we saw there, in the area, smart play not to hold or block in the back right there. A veteran who has been such a big part of Alabama's success over the last 4 years. Got an off day, as Nick Saban termed it, early in the year. Needed a personal day, took care of some things at home, came back, and I know everybody was so thrilled that he was among the 15 seniors honored before this game.
Absolutely, and we saw last year how big of an impact he had before breaking his ankle and then fought back, battled back, actually was able to play in the national championship game had Alabama needed him. But you can't just say, well, this is what the guy brings to the table by what they do on the field. It's the off-the-field leadership that a lot of these seniors possess as well. How you work, how do you come to prepare yourself, and how you overcome this disappointment or that frustration. That's kind of the advice that these older guys who have been through the fire, so to speak, are able to offer the younger guys.
So Chattanooga unable to take advantage of the fumbled punt. Throw a fourth down interception, and now seeing Alabama march down the field, find themselves down 7-0 as again C.J. Board, number 86, and Marquise Green, number 21, are the deep men. The ball stays on the tee this time for Cade Foster, and Green will return it again. Gets it across the 20, lowers his head as he gets to the 26-yard line. Once more, good starting field position for the Mocs of Chattanooga. And again, Terrell Robinson coming out to engineer this offense. He was a second-team preseason All SoCon pick at the wideout slot. Again, his athleticism, Tyler, creates a different dimension. There's no doubt with what Jacob Huseman has done this year, they would prefer to have number 14 available each snap, and they feel like they have a good chance of doing that next week should they make the playoffs. But he is a very versatile athlete.
Yeah, and that's kind of what you're hoping, almost hoping for, is that he's going to give you some of those look from that quarterback position with a read option and what he's able to do from the backfield.
Operate from the gun with four wideouts. And Alabama may have turned off sides there. There was definitely movement.
The layup game. Offense number 6. 5-yard penalty. Still first down.
Step off, obviously, against the Mocs, and that's one of the things you deal with a guy who is not accustomed to taking every snap at quarterback.
And the play clock shorter coming off of a change of possession. Then.
And trying to read one of the best defenses in
there
the country. There's that as well. He'll tuck it and run. He's got a little room across the 20. Finally forced out of bounds by Ha-Ha Clinton Dix around the 25-yard line. It'll be second down and about 10 to go. So he gets back to the original line of scrimmage, or close to it, as we're at the midway point of the opening quarter. Glad you're with us here on Crimson Tide pay-per-view. Chris Stewart, Tyler Watson, our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, is Mick Gillespie. The Crimson Tide trying to go 11-0 on the year. They've already gone 7-0 in conference play, and they will face the Auburn Tigers next week in a monumental Iron Bowl. That's the give. That's about 3.5-4 yards on that play for Kendricks Hewitt. Hewitt, a sophomore, 5'9", 195, out of Norcross High School in Atlanta. First carry of the game for him, and third down and long upcoming. They use a lot of misdirection, Tyler. They run the ball very effectively. In third and mid-range situations, what do you expect to see the majority of the time today from the Mocs?
Well, the first time on third and long, we saw a little end-around reverse. We haven't seen them put the ball in the air that much. Everything they've done has been right around the line of scrimmage.
The pump fake. And now running for his life. That's a great job of playing assignment football there by the Bama defense.
And that's basically a screen to the outside where you're trying to get a good block and get rid of the football, almost like an option run pass tack. He wants to throw it to the slot receiver who's bubbling, but really nice job by cornerback for Alabama to be able to shut that down, right playing right there at the line of scrimmage.
So Christian Jones deep once again as Nick Pollard will come out to punt for the second time. Pollard's had a great year, averaging better than 40 yards per punt. Had a long of 78. Rugby style, trying to kick it away from Jones. Christian this time will not try to field it on a hop. It'll get down around the 21-yard line. So a timeout on the field, 6:39 to go. 7-0, Alabama leading Chattanooga here in Tuscaloosa. To play top-ranked Crimson Tide in Chattanooga. The Mocs 8-3 overall, 6-2 in the Southern Conference. And Tyler, it is an important week. It has been an important week for the Crimson Tide. They had what many would probably term the worst performance a week ago in a 20-7 road victory at Mississippi State. The Tide turned the ball over four times. They really had some things they needed to clean up, and I think that's why the week leading into this game was so big. And now you see if Alabama will indeed bring that back to the playing field.
Offensively, last week was not up to their standards. Defensively, however, they did a lot of really nice things last week versus Mississippi State. But you're right, putting the ball on the ground, the interceptions, the penalties here and there, just the lack of performance offensively are things that you want to work on. And you mentioned it already in the broadcast. You're constantly preaching a faceless opponent. You're wanting to perfect your game and what you're supposed to be doing. And that's really where the focus is needed to be this week as well as next week.
How tough was this week for the Alabama players to not look beyond today's game?
I'm sure that it was a challenge. But you know what? At this point of the game, as many week in and week out as you've gotten in a good rhythm this season, you really don't start thinking 2 and 3 weeks ahead. You're just thinking about the next opponent because you're in a rhythm of doing this on Monday, this Tuesday, this Wednesday, and so on, and trying to learn that game plan and all the variations that go into it. You're really just focused on the job at hand.
Two most physical games, in all likelihood of the year, in the two previous weeks for Alabama, LSU, Mississippi State. Traditionally, that's the case, but the reality was that's what you faced this year as well in those two games.
Yeah, absolutely. And Mississippi State, no one really gave them a lot of respect and credit for the fact that, because you look at their record and it's not as well what you would want it to be and what you would think it would be, but they're a physical football, and they've always been good on the defensive side. And I remember Anthony Steen in a quote he gave this week talking about that was one of the more challenging games they played all year long because of that staunch, stingy defensive front for Mississippi State.
So tied with 1st and 10. Said the ball was actually first touched by Chattanooga around the 29-yard line. So Bamble will have it 1st and 10 there. And Derrick Henry now in the backfield. The single setback. He goes in formation, and Jones will make the catch on the throw. He's got a first down and more. Derrick Henry getting an early look, Tyler Watts, for the Crimson Tide. Of course, Henry, 6'3", 238 out of Yulee, Florida, but the pride of Adamsville, Minor High School's Christian Jones making that grab.
Good patience also by McCarron, looking downfield, trying to force the issue. That backs up all the defensive guys and opens up nice running lane for Christian Jones after the catch.
Swing it out to Amari Cooper, and that's a great play made on the near side by the Mocs defensively. Chaz Moore stepping up and making that hit. Moore is a good one. He's the team captain. And they've got, again, some of the better talent at the FCS level on this Chattanooga defense.
Had an opportunity last week versus Sanford to wrap it up. Fell short there, but you're right, this is a good little football team.
Second about 13 from the 41. Norwood in motion to the bottom of your picture. McCarron forced out of the pocket. Tells Norwood block somebody. He does. McCarron gets the first down and then wisely gets out of bounds. Great communication there between McCarron and Norwood, and a smart play to go ahead and find that boundary.
Yeah, Kevin Norwood, nice job with his body of being able to turn and provide the block there. Get out of bounds, nothing to gain by taking a hit.
Good block on Dothard, the linebacker, who was a preseason All-American and on the Buck Buchanan watch list as well.
There's two ways to block somebody. You can run over them, knock them over, or you can get in their way.
Play action from McCarron. Looking deep, looking for Bell. He's there, and it's broken up at the last moment. Great job again by Chaz Moore. as he got a hand on that when Kenny Bell was open on the deep post, but Moore was able to close quickly.
Kenny kind of had to check up here around the 5-6 yard line and hesitate just to snap second.
Now we know what Kenny Bell was talking about. We thought he got a hand on the ball. He may have gotten the arm instead just before it arrived. Nonetheless, second and 10 upcoming for the Tide as they'll swing it out to Norwood quickly. And again, they do a great job tackling in space. As we take a look at that last play again, Tyler.
This is a better angle right here. Definitely grabbed that right arm of Kenny Bell before the ball got there. Moore doing a good job. You don't want to give up the touchdown here, but you know, a concern last week was A.J. stepping into the ball. He did a nice job of stepping into that throw. A little bit short.
Yeah, when you think it's deflected, it looks like a big underthrow. When you see that it perhaps could have been pass interference, then you realize, well, maybe it was actually on the money. So third and long, Bama converted on one of these on their last drive. Carrick unloading it to Norwood, and he's going to be brought down shy of that first down marker. It's Dothard making the hit. And then also coming out of the pile again is Chaz Moore. And looks like Nick Saban's going to go for it here. Tyler, you're really in between. Call on Cody Mandel, one of the best pooch punters in the nation, but he's trying to work on things today and challenge his team today, and this is a great way to do it on fourth and about four. Jalston Fowler, the single setback, as Jones goes in motion. Cooper to his right, Norwood to his left, as McCarron has time. Now pressure coming, unloads it, and Fowler's going to be brought down back at the 40. Not only do they fail to pick up the first down, they lose yardage on the play, as Chaz Moore again is there to make the stop.
I think that's what Saban's talking to him about, is you got to get five. There's no point in throwing short. It was a tight window. He potentially could have thrown to Howard on an 8-yard out. But you're drilled in your head so often, don't force the ball, don't turn it over. Fourth down situation, you almost have to just try to drill it in there.
So Alabama stopped Chattanooga on a fourth down conversion attempt early. And now the Mocs are able to stop Alabama on downs, as Robinson once more will operate from the gun. Throws a little shuffle pass underneath, and that's going to be complete for a gain of about 6 yards. Fessel Shafat, a tight end, on the receiving end of the shuffle pass, and he'll pick up 7 yards on the play.
And those type of plays right there really force you to be gap sound on the interior and not give up any room there, but in your spacing and all. And really a nice play call, a nice execution by Chattanooga.
So second and three. As the clock ticks near the 2.5 minute mark of the opening quarter. And to give right up the gut. Pick up the first down. First carry of the game for Derek Crane. And Collins making a stop. But again, Chattanooga. Alabama fans are going, what's wrong? But this is not a fluke. This is a very talented Chattanooga team.
You know, we saw the same thing, 2 years ago versus Georgia Southern. Try to tell everybody it's a different offense, that they're talented, they're going to be able to do some things. And it's a lot more difficult of a win than I think most people would have anticipated.
The starters among the elite at the FCS level can play with a lot of teams in the country. As the flag comes in, I should say they can play with a lot of teams in the country at the FBS level. Initial signal is procedure from Hubert Owens.
Illegal formation, offense, number 72, not on the line of scrimmage. 5-yard penalty, still second down.
He said that Patrick Sutton, that's the center, was not on the line of scrimmage.
Huh.
Is that physically possible? Our producer, Tom Amon, with the suggestion that maybe it's just incredibly long arms. So a timeout called for Chattanooga. That will be their second timeout of the half. And we'll keep it right here with a minute 23 to go in the half. To this point, Chattanooga has achieved the objective, Tyler. This is still a ball game.
Yeah.
They're still very much in it. Again, there are teams this year that have been out of it by the end of the first quarter of play. So this is a mini victory for Chattanooga thus far.
I think so. Defensively, they're playing tough. They're kind of stacking the line of scrimmage there. You missed another opportunity, a long touchdown pass. But they're doing exactly what they need to do on the defensive side. And Alabama offensively, they're still not hitting on all cylinders. And that was kind of a concern. It's a slow start in the first quarter, because going forward, you can't afford to have that. But defensively, I think you got to be happy with the performance of your defense. Gave up a first down there, but it was because of a long run there on first down. As you get a look and get the flow of this game, defense will step it up and do a better job.
So first and 15 now. Robinson once more from the gun. Sent Green in motion. They'll throw it over the top, and that's behind the intended receiver, Hewitt. Second and 15. So to come, Mosley in coverage, and Tyler, he can be a tremendous pass rusher, but the athleticism that allows Mosley to cover guys out of the backfield is one of the things that's made him among the most elite in the game.
And pick up on you know, what it is he's supposed to be doing. The recognition of pass versus run, it occurs awfully quick at this level. The speed of the game is so fast, and Mosley makes those decisions as quick as anyone.
That's a great point. He's got the mental awareness as Jonathan Allen greets the mock very rudely. Boy, he's another one of these young guys. We're honoring seniors today, but Allen is among those freshmen who have played quality snaps this year. 6'3", 265 out of Leesburg, Virginia.
That's a good get right there. And it's scary because you know they're only going to get better. They're only going to slim down, get rid of the body fat, bulk up even more.
Allen got it. If he hadn't, Brandon Avery is going to. Third and long now. And that was knocked away on a nice play by Geno Smith. Again, the young corner stepping up as they were trying to connect with Borisciotti out of the backfield. But Smith, another one of those freshmen, worked his way in, or actually a year ago he was a freshman, now a sophomore out of Atlanta. He's been in that rotation at corner opposite ordinarily Deion Blue. Nobody has cemented that spot, and here we are in week 11, but by committee they've done a pretty good job. It's D. Hart fielding this one and dragging a tackler across the 20. That time, Bama going with double return men because of the approach by Pollard trying to kick it away from Christian Jones. Alabama able to field that one and improve field position just a bit. So from the 20, Bama will start first and 10. Spot where that offense needs to start dominating at the line
of
scrimmage.
Yes, I agree completely, and it needs to occur on first down as well. Seems like when Alabama runs the ball on first down, they haven't gotten much. They've been forced really to pass on early downs.
Derrick Henry getting a nod, and he will go for a couple before he's wrapped up on the play. Check down, I'm sorry. Kenyon Drake making the run. And I've got a feeling Kenyon won't be offended by the fact that I confused him with Derrick Henry. Because Kenyon, not the biggest guy out there. Derrick Henry ordinarily is. Shaky first quarter, but the Tide leads at 7-0. 7-0, Alabama leading Chattanooga as we begin the second quarter of play. I'm Chris Stewart along with Tyler Watts, third member of our crew down on the field, our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, Mick Gillespie.
All right, Chris, thank you. In 2009, the Tide played Chattanooga on Senior Day, and Mike Johnson, that was your Senior Day. What do you remember? Now, All-American, you're with the Atlanta Falcons. What do you remember about that back in 2009?
Honestly, it was more of a football thing. You know, we just wanted to keep the pressure on, be able to come out and win the football game and keep the ball rolling into the Auburn game, and hopefully that's what they can do today.
When you signed with Alabama, did you ever expect that the program would turn into this, three national championships in 4 years and a chance to win another one?
I don't think anybody did. I mean, we came here with the highest of expectations, and you can ask anybody in my signing class and around me, we worked our butt off. And, you know, it's all that hard work that put forth has been able to play out here on the field, and Coach Saban's done a tremendous job. So it's all worked out.
Well, it's great to see you, Mike, and we'll send it back up to Tyler and Chris.
Thank you, Mike. And boy, what a career he had in that 2009 national championship team. It was a perfect year. And Alabama this season, for the sixth consecutive year, Tyler, winning 10 ball games, of course, hoping for more. But six straight years to do that, that's a record.
That's
the
impressive.
University of Alabama. Yeah. Speaking of impressive, Kenyon Drake, and he finds space. Very impressive as well. He's got a dimension to his game that, for all the great running backs that have been here under Coach Saban, that guy has a little extra juice.
He's got some wheels, and if he can ever get in open space, there's very few at this level that can run with him and catch it. But the thing that's kind of deceiving is that he's a tough runner inside as well.
Talking about his size earlier, he's 6'1", 201. As that one is thrown to DeAndre White, he makes the grab. He'll step out of bounds a couple of yards shy of that first down bar. But, yeah, he and Derrick Henry, same time in the backfield. Henry, 6'3", 238. Yeah, he's got 35, almost 40 pounds on him. He may arrive at their destinations a little bit differently, but both find a way to get there. Here's Drake. Running between the tackles, just as Tyler talked about, and kept the legs churning. He's got the first down and a little bit more.
I love watching running backs, though, that refuse to fall backwards. Not necessarily go backwards. They just sort of communicate with Anthony Steen there, talking about how I need to cut off your block and how I want you to set him up. Guys that relentlessly are trying to fall forward.
Three wideouts in formation. There's Jones moving into the slot. Bottom of the picture. Again, it'll be Drake. And again, he bounces it to the outside. And again, he finds running room past the first down marker. He's down to the 32. Bumped out of bounds by the cornerback there, D. Virgin. It's a 14-yard pickup. Drake to move the chains again.
He's trying to go to the inside once again. O.J. Howard, pretty good block on that back side. Filling in for Ron Vogler.
So Drake will get a breather, and here's Derrick Henry. Howard, the tight end to the right. And they'll run that direction. And the big horse wants to run. Derrick Henry, forget about going out of bounds. He will carry it to the 5-yard line. Kadeem Wise held on for the ride as Henry picks up another first down for Alabama.
That might have been the neatest part right there at the tail end, the fact that it looks like he's going to just make contact and go out of bounds, but right there, able to stay in bounds, pick up an extra, 8 yards?
There are ponies, there are Colts, and then there are Clydesdales. Mr. Henry falling into that final category as Bama's got first and goal from the 5. And Derrick Henry rumbles his way to the end zone for his second Alabama touchdown. Again, Kadeem Wise had the misfortune of being in his path as Derrick Henry scores the second TD of the year for number 27 and the second of the ball game for Alabama. First coming on the run from Kenyon Drake. Foster, perfect on that one. From the hold of A.J. McCarron. Nolan Mazza with a snap. And number 27 rumbling his way into the end zone. Bama now with a 14-0 lead here early in quarter number two. Not many programs in America that can have your starting running back, such as T.J. Yeldon, as good as he is, held out. Now let's run the number three guy, and he looks like that.
So you're picking between sophomore, two sophomores, a freshman. There's a trend there at the running back level. They're all young. And you're right. It's, if any, there's very little drop-off. I think the only drop-off that there really is experience, and that's something that will come with time also.
Again, he set the national rushing record for most yards in a career, coming out of Yulee, Florida. Another reason why Alabama had one of the top signing classes, the number one ranked signing class in America last year. Boy, everybody wanted to see him in the spring, but he got at the A-Day game, he got hurt. And I won't say that slowed his development, but did slow his progress a little bit. When you have such phenomenal numbers as he did in high school, everybody thinks you're going to walk in immediately and get major playing time. And he has worked his way into a role with his football teams, whether it's on special teams, whether it's in the offense as we've seen today. And he is a young man with an extremely bright future.
Yeah, he offers a lot. And you mentioned the special teams. How many guys on both sides of the ball have we seen, not only that they start and they play and play special teams, but they'll get their starting in their career here at Alabama on special teams. You can find out a lot if a guy's willing to go run down the field, throw his body around, and go on punt, return, punt, cover, kind of what he'll do when he gets up on the offensive and defensive side.
Three different guys have carried the ball for a total of 10 attempts for the Tide in this one. Bama now over the century mark, 105 yards rushing as kick returned across the 20 to about the 22-yard line. Marquise Green with that return. Chattanooga coming back out offensively. And again, Jacob Huseman, their regular starter, limited in what he can do because of a leg injury, and I think they're doing that, going with limited snaps for him. If this were round one of the playoffs at the FCS level, you could probably see it, Tyler, but with those playoffs looming, they're going to be very careful and pick their spots with it.
And you have to. You have to protect your assets for when it really counts.
Another nice run from Derek Crane as he gets the ball across the 25, and it's to the 27-yard line. Glad to have you with us for this presentation of the Crimson Tide Sports Network pay-per-view from CTSN. Chris Stewart, Tyler Watts, Mick Gillespie down on the sidelines, our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, is. The Mocs had second and five, and nowhere to go for Crane there as C.J. Mosley wraps him up and brings him down for a loss of about a yard and a half. Tyler, we talked about what he is capable of doing physically, but you're right, the vision that he has to know where he needs to be almost makes it illegal.
You know, you're illegal? Why not?
It's almost unfair.
You sit there and watch film over and over and over, and you say, all right, here's a formation, expect this, this, and this. And he knows what's coming. He knows right there, all right, I know he's going to bounce it out, and this is the hole he's going to want to go in, and I'm going to beat him there to it. It's one thing to recognize, and another is to react and be able to execute. He does it as good as anybody.
Crane gets to the edge and puts up nice yardage, but he's going to be shy of that first down marker. He picked up five on the play to the 30. Maybe something they come back to a little bit later, but they needed about eight. Yeah, they only got three. So in all likelihood, head coach Russ Huseman will bring the punting unit on, and that's exactly what he does here. Nick Pollard on to punt. Jones waiting on this one. Makes one man miss. Now just trying to read things. Oh, they read it well. Christian Jones to the house. Touchdown, Alabama. 75 yards. Second punt return for a score this year by the junior out of Minor High School.
Finally got one to return. That looks like Javi Arenas gets this squad back in 09.
Yeah, no.
How a guy can sit back there, concentrate on that ball while someone's barreling down on him, catch it, and immediately know where he is, will always amaze me with punt returners. Another nice job of blocking down the punter by Kenny Bell.
Let's say the senior doing a great job there in special teams to pave the way for Christian Jones. And just like that, Alabama has made it a 21-0 lead with an escort from Trey DePriest and Dylan Lee. Christian Jones gives Bama a 3-score advantage. 5-yard punt return after a 45-yard punt. And Alabama with a 21-0 lead. Christian Jones, really something special.
Alti Tenpenny doing a nice job. You see the wall was set up there, and there's a block by Kenny Bell, but there weren't a lot of blocks being thrown because he kind of set all of it up himself by going to left and then getting that wall set up, and, hey, Chattanooga was nowhere in position.
Another senior, John Fulton, saw running interference early in that play as well, and you talked about it. I mean, we could all see Gunner coming after him.
Yeah.
And he sensed it as well. Didn't make a big move. Didn't panic. Didn't call for a fair catch. And didn't get lit up on the play like it looked as though he may.
Well, if you're going to be a skill guy in football, though, you can't be tunnel vision. You have to have excellent peripheral vision and just kind of have a feel of where everybody is. And those guys display it more than anyone.
So after a little bit of a shaky start, Jones misplaying a punt. They'd gone with a rugby style on two or three previous punts. And I have a feeling that they will go back to that the rest of the day.
Yes.
Staying warm, any means necessary. Coach Saban even going with a jacket today. You don't see that very often. But certainly with the temperature starting today at 50 and dropping over the course of the afternoon, those are nice to have here in Tuscaloosa on this cloudy afternoon.
I'd rather have one of those in a sport coat, huh?
Yeah. Did you not get that email? Again, Cade Foster on to kick off, one of 15 seniors playing their final games here today at Bryant-Denny Stadium. Short kick. It'll be fielded around the six.
That's better. You know, that's kind of been a concern the last couple of weeks also. Start off versus LSU. What had been a strength all year long was the kickoff covers, and LSU took one back in, what, the third or fourth quarter? Third quarter, I suppose it was. Outside the 10-15-yard line, and it's kind of been spotty here and there since then, but much better job of getting down the field and closing up those running lanes.
Taharan Tyson hobbling off the field, but 15-yard return on the part of C.J. Board, and Alabama forcing Chattanooga to start now at their own 19-yard line. Terrell Robinson is the quarterback. Again, primarily used as a wide receiver throughout the year, but with Jacob Huseman battling a leg injury, they've used Robinson as they bounce it to the near side. That is Hewitt, who is able to get to the edge. And Kendricks Hewitt picks up about 6 or 7 yards It was Maurice Smith that was trying to cut him off on the edge, but a good job of bouncing it to the outside. You see a little speed there.
And Maurice Smith, that one extra step inside as he's going to pursue the ball ended up being the difference in losing containment. And those are the type of things that you need to – you have to get out there and see it before you can adjust correctly and take the right angles.
So the total yardage favoring the Tide, 75 of those coming on that punt return a few minutes ago from Christian Jones for a score. As there is nowhere to go. Robinson kept it himself, and of course the play had been blown dead before the ball came out. Jerick Williams, a young man, Tyler, has done a nice job this year. He has kind of got pressed into service early and earned the opportunity there, and has been one of the more solid contributors in that secondary.
Yeah, he'll get after it back there too, and he's a lot like Landon Collins in his ability to do a good job in pass coverage, but also he will come up and lay the lead, so to speak.
Another guy from South Alabama, Mobile product from Blount High School. So third and a short five. It's Green going in motion. They'll swing it out. And first down and more as they go to Derek Crane again. And the big fella has rumbled his way for some nice yardage in this game. That's an 18-yard pickup.
Cyrus Jones kind of got blocked up, and Hubbard missed the tackle there at the line of scrimmage.
Isn't that the part that Nick Saban will be most displeased with? If you're out of position, that's one thing, but if you're there and don't make the play. Yeah. Again, he was just coming
tackle.
Off of the blocker. Or perhaps even a hold, as we saw the replay again. But nonetheless, not able to get him to the turf. They swing it out quickly. Another missed tackle and another first down for Chattanooga. That's Boy Shoddy, who was able to make the play.
See, and that's a play right there with Maurice Smith where you just have to come up and make the good tackle. Be under control. You don't lunge after a ball carrier. He'll beat you. You have to be under control. Bring your pads with you.
Landon Collins. Again, another who in the offense has been, or the defense, excuse me, major, major factor this year for Alabama after being primarily a special teams contributor a year ago. First and 10 after the third first down this game, but a flag comes in quickly. Blow this one dead.
Ball start. Offense. Number 86, 5-yard penalty, still first down.
Chattanooga just can't afford to make those type mistakes.
Although this has been a relatively impressive drive, what they've been able to do.
C.J. Board guilty of the infraction. And Russ Huseman, head coach, and a great job. They've won a share of the Southern Conference title. Could win it outright if Furman and Samford both lose today, but guaranteed at least a share of that conference championship. As again, Robinson tried to keep his feet, was able to pick up about 3 or 4 yards. Talked about it earlier, 2009, Alabama beat Chattanooga on Senior Day en route to a perfect year and a national title. 2 years ago, on their way to the 2011 BCS crown, Alabama faced another Southern Conference foe, Georgia Southern. They ran that triple option that was awfully tough. You may remember Alabama was on about their third or fourth string nose guard that day. And it took them a half before they started to read things, and they are starting to have some issues now with that Chattanooga offense. It was Green making the grab. Marquise Green on that quick out. They're having success on the edge.
Doing a good job. Maurice Smith, again, getting blocked there, getting cut. He'll actually come out of the game. And it's not because he's in trouble. It's because he's trying to get coached up there on the sideline. Coach Saban's down there right now talking it over with him. Bradley Silva will come in.
That's good to see for Alabama. Silva has missed a good bit of action cause of injury and gets in the game here as they go to Hewitt and gets tripped up there by Landon Collins. Kendricks Hewitt had his name called a few times here in the opening half. Beyond the midway point of quarter number two, a 21-0 Alabama lead. Tide had a turnover, special teams by Christian Jones, but made up for it as he had the most recent score for the Tide on the 75-yard punt return. Prior to that, a Derrick Henry touchdown run of 5 yards and the first score of the game coming on a touchdown run from Kenyon Drake. Second and 10 now for the Mocs. Play action from Robinson. Looking deep. And good coverage by the Crimson Tide. The ball was overthrown, but you also had the numbers working out well for Alabama. The math favoring Bama 3-2.
Landon Collins doing a good job from that safety position. Jerick Williams also in good coverage.
They're trying to go to Borisciotti, and he had two options near the goal line, Tyler, but both of them were covered.
Neither one of them were good. A good decision.
So third and long upcoming, third and right at 10, from just outside the Alabama 30-yard line.
Interesting if they run it here. More than likely will mean they'll go for it on fourth down, but I think they'd like to come away with points.
Pressure coming as Robinson rolls, throws, and ha-ha, Clinton Dix is able to make the interception, or is he? They're going to discuss it, and I said it was Clinton Dix. It was actually Cyrus Jones who did a great job of at least giving himself a chance at the interception, even though it is ruled an incomplete pass.
See here if he was able to keep his feet in.
Ooh,
there.
That's, mercy.
That's close.
Wow. They will review that. They review every play. Can't review holding.
But yeah, that right foot, though, did hit in the white, I think, before that left foot dragged. Watch the right foot. It comes down first.
Yep. It's a great call. That's
out of bounds. See, this is not difficult to review plays. I could do it.
48-yard try is blocked. Kicked around, scramble ensues, and I think Chattanooga's going to come up with it. It doesn't matter. Alabama's going to have possession inside the 45-yard line of the Mocs. So Bama special teams, Tyler, which have been great from the start of the year, come up with another nice play.
Pressure right up the middle, and that, because of the length, you force the incomplete pass on third and 10 that sets up a 48-yard field goal there, and you have to kick it at a low trajectory.
Kicked it right into the chest of A'shaun Robinson, which doesn't mean necessarily that it's a low kick. A'shaun Robinson, 6'4", 320, able to take up some space as Alabama holds a 21-0 lead. Watson, Mick Gillespie, I'm Chris Stewart. Glad to have you with us as Alabama and Chattanooga square off here at Bryant-Denny Stadium. The Tide with a nice block, and you're going to see number 86 in the middle of your picture. He did throw the arms up there. I don't know that he got it with the hand. It may have been the elbow or the armpit, though. That's a freshman, ladies and gentlemen. First time I saw him without the helmet, I thought, wow. When you say, you know, guys, the build looks like a grown man.
Some people are just mature looking in the face as well.
I'm still not at that.
Are you checking him out?
Yeah, A'shaun Robinson, unbelievable talent. And again, 6'4", 320 pounds.
Kind of just slides in. He blows his guys up and pushes him back, what, 3-4 yards, and then just takes it to the chest. Coach Gaspard sees that. He might turn him into a catcher.
Good luck with that. Although, the guy that's going to contend for playing time behind the plate, Will Haney, is about 6'6". You don't see many 6'5", 6'6", catchers.
You don't see many willing to squat down that long.
Yeah. It's Alabama, great starting field position. From the 42 of Chattanooga, A.J. McCarron. A win today, the winningest starting quarterback in Alabama history. Currently tied with Jay Barker on that list with 50. victories as the starting quarterback. Already the all-time touchdowns leader, passing yardage leader, among the best records in the history of the SEC. In fact, percentage points better than Barker as far as being the winningest SEC quarterback of all time. The 35 wins are the most. More than Danny Werfel's 32 and Buck Ballou's 27. McCarron looking deep, looking for Derrick Henry, and can't quite come up with it. That's good coverage on the part of the Mox. McKeevian Leslie there with him step for step. And again, there is a chance or two that you may take up 21 and nothing, yeah, Tyler, that you wouldn't ordinarily take.
Thinking the exact same thing. That might have been one of those decisions of, I could check it down here for 5-6 yards, or I could go for a wheel route.
Empty set. Charleston Fowler in the slot, top of your picture. Kenny Bell to the bottom of your screen. You got a timeout called by Chattanooga as they did not like what they saw.
It's that third and final timeout.
Hubert Owens, reminding us that they have now burned their three for the half, but, you know, minus a play or two, Chattanooga right in this ball game as we check in with Mick Gillespie.
Well, we're on the sideline here, Chris, as you know, and we've had the wind all day. When you're in the south end zone, it's unbelievable. It's coming straight at your face, but it also hits you on the side of your head at the same time. Now mix in the rain, and that started to fall. Field conditions are really good right now, but if the rain picked up with this wind, it could be a treacherous second half to be a sideline guy. I'll send it back up to you.
I've got to tell you, partner, I'm glad to have my vantage point today. Tom Roberts was giving me the evil eye during Crimson Tide pregame on radio. Ordinarily, that is my role on a game day, and instead we're sitting here high and dry, nice and toasty inside the press box at Bryant-Denny Stadium. Well, not exactly nice and toasty, but better than what those guys are dealing with right now. Bama's dealing with third and about five. Delayed give, Kenyon Drake, and he is wrapped up. Boy, I thought he was about ready to pick up the first down and maybe a lot more, Tyler, but DJ Key was able to grab him quickly and get him to the ground.
Eric Quanja real slow getting up.
Don't like seeing that. The left guard, Ari
he's
Quanja.
He's going to get back down.
Yeah, he's calling for the staff, and that's the thing in any ball game. Obviously, you don't want to see injuries, but when you are heading down the home stretch, you're undefeated, you've got your arch rivals waiting next week in what will be one of the biggest Iron Bowls ever. You want to make sure you got all hands on deck, and boy, they just got
rolled
that
up.
Knee rolled. Thank goodness they wear the braces. That gives you a little bit of a fighting chance.
Hey.
I know.
You can put all the titanium on you want. That ain't natural. Linemen are the toughest. They're like little kids, though. They're almost made of rubber in the fact that it hurts, but he's mad.
Yeah, as much as anything.
But I guarantee you, give him 15 minutes, he could probably go back out there and play.
Hope that's the case. Fourth down, Bama's going to go for it. Second time they've tried it today on fourth down. They failed on their first attempt. McCarron with time, swings it near side. Catch made, Amari Cooper, first down, as he is corralled at the 28-yard line. Kadeem Wise was there, so too was Leslie again.
That's really not wasn't bad coverage, though, for a one-on-one situation, because with Cooper, you're so concerned about the deep threat. But Wise staying right there in his hip pocket, actually pretty nice job of coverage.
So with Quanjo out, Kellen Williams, senior in at left guard. He's one of those versatile guys that can play three or four spots on the line as they look deep for Norwood. Catch is made. Touchdown, Alabama. 29 yards on the scoring play, and Bama leads it now 27-0.
Well, all day long, you're trying to get the safety out of the middle of the field, and he's been wandering around, but completely vacated. You got a one-on-one situation with a little post there with Norwood. He uses his body to shield the defender as well as anyone on this team.
71st career touchdown pass for A.J. McCarron. For Norwood, that's his sixth TD grab of the year, the 11th of his Alabama career in the Crimson Tide after the extra point from Cade Foster. Now with a 28-0 lead over the Mocs with 2:18 to go in the half. Finishing the half strong, something Nick Saban always wants to see, and now it'll be up to the defense to finish because the offense did its job.
That's right. The last series, the defense kind of gave up a bunch of first downs before putting a stop to the Chattanooga offense, and it'd be interesting to see if they could force a three and out right now with Alabama having the complement of all three timeouts. Would they go into that two-minute drill just for the work?
Tell you what, it is not at capacity, but given the conditions, not a bad turnout at all at Bryant-Denny Stadium. It is senior day, and a lot of people were here very early to see those seniors recognized before the game. Always amazed. It's the seventh year, but always amazed, Tyler, at for a man like Nick Saban, who is so regimented in what he does and doesn't like the routine broken, how he takes the amount of time that is taken to recognize the seniors before the game, I think very, very special.
Well, no, there's no question that it is. And from the standpoint also of just thinking about that, of that's important to them. You know, we never got honored as seniors, and that's something that's relatively new that he has brought here to Alabama, but I think it's quite appropriate.
Especially for what this class has done.
And it also kind of humanizes the players also. And you see once again, hey, you know what, they don't wear helmets all day long, and they actually have parents.
They do have family, and it's special for the family to be on the field with them before this final game at Bryant-Denny Stadium. As Board returns it across the 15, and he'll get brought down around the 19-yard line. So we'll see what Russ Huseman opts to do. The head coach of the Chattanooga Mocs, my guess is they'll keep it on the ground and try to get to the locker room. Only down 28-0. I won't say this is a meaningless game for Chattanooga, but in terms of how it affects the rest of their season, the playoffs starting next week, that could certainly help them from an at-large perspective if they were to knock off Alabama. But the reality is, down 28-0, not very likely. And they also want to get themselves healthy and ready to go for next week should they get their names called for the playoffs.
And I guess that's the frustrating part is the fact that you're not guaranteed next week. So this potentially could be it. And if that is the case, then you want everyone to play and play hard.
Get Sanford and Furman playing their final regular season games. And both are in conference play. So both could earn a share of the SoCon crown with Chattanooga. Robinson on second down at about 4. They are in no hurry. Play clock to tick down to about 2 before they snap it. There's Hewitt once again. There is Trey DePriest once again. What a hit from number 33. You know, Tyler, C.J. Mosley has been the guy in the middle of that linebacking core. Could fall on Trey DePriest next year. He's a junior, 6'2", 245 out of Springfield, Ohio, and his career has somewhat flown by.
That's amazing. That's a good way of putting it. Another guy that started off on special teams. Remember he and Vinny Sinceri always flying down the field, making all the tackles on kickoff coverage, and he has evolved into a pretty good little linebacker.
And really and truly, it's one of the more amazing things to me is Chattanooga on third down will keep it on the ground with Robinson, and he's going to be close to that first down marker. Nick Saban recruits 4- and 5-star players and then gets them to accept their role. He helps them identify what that role is and then gets them to accept it, and it can be you've been one of the top running backs in all of America coming out of high school, but your role is on special teams. It's going to find a way to get in. And the guys that are real football players are fine with that because they want on the field.
Well, and we also don't know to what extent the older guys are saying, trust what they're doing, because we started off and we have evolved into this position. That's where you have to start.
That being said, he gets the old guys to buy into it as well, such as C.J. Mosley, who we see quite a bit on special teams as well. Head coach Nick Saban in just a moment. We'll talk with our Tom Roberts as we borrow him from the radio side of things and we get the thoughts of the Bama head coach.
First half. Well, you know, we have a lot of respect for the way this team, you know, plays with a lot of toughness. They're really well coached, run a lot of options, make it difficult to do a lot of stuff and play basic defense. And other than giving up a couple screen passes, you know, we've done okay so far. Just want our players to play good so we build some momentum for, you know, what we got to do down the road, and want to continue to do that in the second half.
Good deal. Thanks, Coach.
All right, thank you.
Thank you, Coach. Thank you, Tom. As we have come to halftime here in Tuscaloosa, 28-0 your score, the top-ranked Alabama Crimson Tide finding many different ways to put points on the board and lead 28-0 over Chattanooga. Can get there, not a perfect half, but boy, the momentum built as that first half wore on.
And it always inevitably seems that as soon as the second quarter starts, the offense is going to get into gear and really start churning out some yardage. And today was no different. They really are able to do what they wanted to there in the second quarter. Didn't put themselves in bad down and distance situations and were able to get a lot.
So Nick Saban bringing his team out for the start of the second half. And Tyler, the mode has been in games that are out of reach to go with the starters the first drive of the second half and then start to work in your second and third teamers from there. But you kind of get the sense he wants to see a sharp start to this second half.
I think that's more important than the points that are scored. And four possession game right now, honestly, I think you're probably going to see the starters another two possessions if things go well. And then he's going to start taking them out one at a time.
Yeah, it's a case especially, too, where you wonder how he'll bring the seniors out. Will he do so collectively as a group? Will he bring those seniors out one at a time? That's something that'll take care of itself later. They want to have a good start to this second half. And look at the big fella rumble right there. Xavier Dixon on the return. No fair catch there. He was going to get all he could get on that one.
Oh, I love it. And that's fun for those guys, too. He wouldn't do that versus Tennessee, I promise.
So there's McCarron, who again in the first half did a nice job with the Alabama offense. Very efficient as always, 9 of 12, 110 yards with the one touchdown. Looking, he has Kenny Bell, and the catch is made for a first down.
That's a really nice route by Kenny Bell. He explodes off the line of scrimmage, run down the cushion, make them think that you're going deep, and then break it out.
Again, if you're just joining us, three Bama starters offensively, or actually three starters total, held out today just as a precaution. Brian Vogler at tight end. T.J. Yeldon starting running back for the Crimson Tide. Both of those guys kind of battling ankle injuries. Then you got Deion Blue, who has been battling a toe, a turf toe that's kind of plagued him throughout the course of the season. So second down and about three. Set up that bubble screen for Christian Jones and makes a couple of guys miss and needs to make one more. Almost did. Flags coming in late.
Kenyon Drake's going to get called for pushing the back there after the play.
Kadeem Wise finally forced Christian Jones
after the play was over.
Out of bounds.
Personal foul, unnecessary roughness, 71 on the offense. 15 yards, correct, 17, correction, 17 on the offense. 15 yards from the end of the run. Result of the play was a first down.
Cyrus Quanjo goes, I didn't do anything. And they said, nope, it's 17, not 71. Kenyon Drake goes, but I didn't do anything. So, but it will be that push in the back you referenced that was just unnecessary at the end of the play. Didn't see it there on the replay. I didn't see it as it took place, but I'm sure at some point Nick Saban will see it if he hasn't already.
Well, when the defender falls to the ground, it looks a little more egregious than he just gets hit.
Carrot dumping this one off. Brother to brother on senior day. How about that connection? And he comes over to give his brother the pat on the head. But he goes, dadgummit, turn it upfield. How special is that for those two guys?
I imagine that's probably pretty neat. Both pretty emotional.
Corey McCarron.
Players.
Corey McCarron, the brother of AJ, started his career at South Alabama and then made his way to the capstone. DJ Key with a stop there.
Done a really nice job, and so we always talk about this in the second half. It's a matter of time as you start seeing him inch his way into that defensive backfield before he really breaks one loose.
Third and a yard, and Drake gets the first down. And again, we talk about his ability to bounce it to the outside or just on the edge, absolutely accelerate and blow past people. Tyler, he is, as you've pointed out, not afraid to go between the tackles and put the head down and
that
barrel
play right
his way.
There. Yeah, and that play right there, he potentially could have bounced it to the outside and got in a much bigger gain, but the situation called for the first down to be picked up, and that's what he did, lower the shoulders and pick up the first down.
D. Hart checked out. I'm sorry, Derrick Henry in the game. Play action to him, looking deep for Amari Cooper. He is there. Touchdown, Alabama. 38 yards on the throw and catch, and Alabama now with a 34-0 lead. Good block from O.J. Howard, among others, as Alabama connects deep once again.
Play not a whole lot different than the touchdown that Kevin Norwood scored on, where you hit the slip of receiver and back there on the post route.
Extra point. Good once again. As Kate Foster is now 5 for 5 on the day. A.J. McCarron, his second touchdown strike. Amari Cooper on the receiving end as Bama adds to the lead. Karen throws in this stadium. May not have been a perfect spiral as we saw in the slow-mo replay, but it doesn't matter in the least.
Oh, it was a perfect pass. Perfect pass. That'd be a good one to end on, wouldn't it? There's the play action. You talked about the O.J. Howard block. That's a great job of pushing your guy upfield, creating the pocket there. And yeah, it might not have been. We'll blame it on the wind, though, for the lack
exactly
of spiral.
Right.
That's what I'm thinking was happening. But he stepped into the throw. That's what we didn't see last week. That's what you're wanting to see. Give your receiver an opportunity to catch that ball. Mark Cooper's going to come down with a whole lot more than he lets go.
Tell you what, 12 months ago was really Amari Cooper's time of the year for the Crimson Tide. He was so good at the end of last season, kind of worked his way through some injuries earlier in this season, but there is no questioning the dynamic that he brings to the Alabama offense.
He's a threat, and he's, I think he scares defensive coordinators as much as anything because they see his ability to get down the field and use that speed. And if he can continue to get that confidence going and work within this offense, that's a huge asset for Alabama. All right.
You
wear the overalls, you wear the hat.
Exactly right. There's Blake Sims, who is in all likelihood about to loosen up and get ready to come into the game. The Gainesville, Georgia native, the junior for Coach Nick Saban. He's the other quarterback who's taken snaps this year. Really, those are the only two, McCarron and Sims. And while Alabama has been so good this year, there were a couple of those early season games. They probably would have liked to have played some other guys a few more snaps, but it took them a little while to get going. But once the Tide did, they have been awfully, awfully impressive.
And the second half is really where they've really gotten productive offensively.
Touchback from Cade Foster. You never know, that might be his last kick at Bryant-Denny Stadium. 35-0, the Crimson Tide with a lead. And Chattanooga set to begin 1st and 10 from their own 25-yard line. I know that they obviously would have liked to stop to begin the second half, but you got to think that there's some variation of a halftime speech from Russ Huseman that dealt with guys, forget the scoreboard, let's go play football.
Absolutely, because you're not guaranteed next week and you want to have a good performance out here. And you did some positive things there in the first half. You just didn't finish two drives, two scoring opportunities you had, and you kind of came away with nothing.
So 1st and 10 for the Mocs, and Terrell Robinson getting to go at quarterback all but two or three snaps. Hewitt is on the carry, and there's nothing but crimson waiting on him as he got to the line of scrimmage. Jeffrey Pagan leading the charge. Tyler, you're losing some great seniors off this Alabama squad, but only 15 of them, 12 of which I believe are scholarship seniors. Guys like Jeffrey Pagan are why there's so much excitement about what lies ahead in the years to come.
As well as the youth behind guys in Pagan's class.
Hewitt, that very lengthy pitch. And I'm sure he's going, come on, come on, come on, get here. Because he knew the defense would. Landon Collins getting the tackle. But he had a lot of help behind him.
I tell you what, Geno Smith, number 24 at the corner position. They can get the tackle, but watch him fight off his defender, his blocker, and get a hand in there. Because that wide receiver couldn't do anything with Geno Smith, running back can't make a decision on where to go. That allows plenty of time for Landon Collins to come in and clean up.
See anything Bama did to adjust? Because Chattanooga was having some success on the edge late in the second quarter.
Well, I think they're doing a much better job on these first two plays of the half on the front four of just stalemating that line of scrimmage and kind of reading what's going on.
They go back to the corner again, but on 3rd and long, Trey DePriest gets the stop of Robinson after a gain of about 2.5. So the Tide forcing Chattanooga into 4th and long and in all likelihood another punting situation. Alabama in the first half forcing Nick Pollard into 4 punts for an average of 45 yards. Of course, one of those was returned at 75 yards for a touchdown. The only one of his 4 that was not the rugby style. Makes you think we will see him go with that approach again. And he does, trying to just kick it away from 22. And that one hits off the back of Kenny Bell. And then after it caroms off the hands of DeHart, Bell winds up on top of it. That is a tough deal right there, and it's part of why you go with that rugby style if you're Chattanooga.
Yeah, well, a lot of good things can happen. You see Kenny Bell, he's trying to block somebody down the field, and he's 15 yards to the side and ends up hitting.
Bama will have it with great field position when we come back. Damp, downright cool afternoon here in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. Temperatures around 50 degrees just before kickoff, and they have been dropping throughout the course of the ball game. But the tide has been rising. 35-0 is your score. The number one team in America leading Chattanooga out of the football championship subdivision of NCAA Division I. And the tide looking very sharp to start the second half. Marching down the field, touchdown pass, A.J. McCarron to Kevin Norwood after he got to throw a pass to his brother Corey for the first time. Completed that one, and the tide up 35-0 midway through the third quarter of play, and that's a good time to bring in Blake Sims at quarterback.
Give him an opportunity to get in there. Plenty of time to work on various things, and, I agree completely. Unless... Well, no less about it. I think that he's the one that's going to get in there.
He'll come in, but he'll also have some company. Leon Brown at left tackle. Kellen Williams at left guard. Chad Lindsey in now at center. At right guard, I think you can see Alphonse Taylor. And then also at right tackle, you're going to see one of the young guys as well. Basically a brand new offensive unit for the Crimson Tide, minus the wideouts. You got Kenny Bell in there, who sees a lot of snaps, and Derrick Henry has his number called, and he'll pick up about 6 or 7 yards on first down. And Grant Hill was the other lineman I was trying to get to, Tyler. Grant Hill, very talented true freshman who got some playing time early, and Saban's very excited about what he can do in his Alabama career.
Yeah, and it's going to take some getting used to saying Grant Hill. I always have to check myself on that.
You're not thinking hoops, are you?
I am. I'm not a basketball player, fan.
Kenny Bell on the receiving end of the 19th completion on the year by Blake Sims. Chaz Moore making the stop. I'm the one that's going to see Duke play next week.
Yeah, you are, aren't you?
And you're throwing out references from the 80s and 90s with the Blue Devils. Alabama basketball did earn its way to Madison Square Garden semifinals of the NIT season tip-off starting Wednesday night. We'll have it for you on the Crimson Tide Sports Network starting at 8 o'clock Central. Derrick Henry again barreling his way for a first down and then some. Gets across midfield into Chattanooga territory at the 49. Bama and Duke on Wednesday. And the Tide will also play on Friday. We'll have that one for you on the network also. And then, of course, a little football game next weekend down on the plains. Biggest Iron Bowl in years. One of the biggest ever. Alabama will again go in as the number one ranked team in America, and Auburn currently number 6, could be even higher by the time that one kicks off on Saturday afternoon. Near pick right there from the Mox as DJ Key stepped in front of Kenny Bell, got a hand on it, almost got both hands on the football.
Tough when you got the safety walk down like this or linebacker outside. You know he's got flat responsibility. The corner's going to be able to back up. That's a tough, tight window to be able to throw that 5 yard out in.
Raheem Falkins in at wide receiver for Alabama. He's to the top of your picture. Chris Black in to the slot left side as they go to Derrick Henry. Looking for a block, then looking for people to run over, and is finally going to be brought down right around the 30-yard line. Davis Tull among those that helped get him to the ground, but you see, once the big fella gets it headed in one direction, it's tough to bring down.
Yeah, and that was a nice job also by Blake Sims of riding Henry into the line of scrimmage. That freezes that defensive end and prevents him from making the decision to collapse or get upfield. That kind of opened up a little bit more of a hole for Derrick Henry.
Brandon Green, the tight end to the near side for Alabama, as Charleston Fowler joins Henry in the backfield along with Blake Sims. It's actually going to be Chris Black who took the handoff, changes direction, dives, and scores. What a move by Chris Black. They lined him up in the backfield, and I misread the dreadlocks. Those were his and not Derrick Henry's. As we see the speed that made him one of the top performers in the A-Day game 2 years ago before his knee injury.
He is exciting when he has the ball in his hands. Earlier in the season, I think he took a little swing pass, similar situation, opposite end, and took it in for a score. So hasn't played a ton this year, but already has two touchdowns.
41-0 with 5.5 to go, and Foster staying perfect on the year on PATs. As Alabama has had six different players find the end zone today. Chris Black, the most recent. Nothing Alabama with a lead over Chattanooga. 5.5 minutes to go in the third quarter. As we take a look at the touchdown run again for Chris Black. Just line him up in the backfield, Tyler. He got a couple of nice blocks, one of them from Charleston Fowler.
And you can't block everybody. Key number 20 for Chattanooga, the safety, comes down, and he's in the hole to make the stop, but Chris Black able to kind of sidestep him, use that speed. And, boy, is he fast.
31 yards on the carry as Chris Black found the end zone, and the Crimson Tide finds the scoreboard once again. This was a 7-0 ball game, I believe, late in the first quarter. But the Tide has gained momentum and really done a nice job against the Mocs. As we check in with our Cooks Pest Control sideline reporter, here's Mick Gillespie.
In last week's game, Cody Mandel was a big part of it. The punter was the Ray Guy Player of the Week. He's also a finalist for the National Award for the best punter in the country. Had two kicks over 60 yards and a 55-yard average. We haven't seen him today, but it's senior day. We did see his family, except for his brother, Doug. He's out on an Air Force carrier, and, this package right here, a great look at what's going on with his family and Doug.
Hey, Cody. Sorry I can't be there. Underway right now, but just wanted to congratulate you. Tell you how proud I am of you, how far you've come. Not everybody can say that, hey, my little brother plays for the number one team in the nation. I just wanted to congratulate you, man. Love you. Keep doing what you're doing, man. Roll Tide.
What a great greeting there from Cody Mandel's brother to the Tide senior, guy who was a walk-on, Tyler, and he said he told us last week on radio, he said, I just came to Alabama and I simply wanted to be great. And
he's turned wanted into excellence.
He really has. It's gotten better and better.
And that's the thing. It seems like 2 years ago he was averaging, and I'm probably wrong on this, but it seems like he was averaging 38, 39 yards a kick. And it has just, last year and this year, has really grown that number and has been a huge asset for the Alabama special teams.
47 yards per punt with a long of 63. 12 of his punts have been over 50 yards. But just as important, Tyler, 13 of those have been down inside the 20-yard line.
That's huge right there. He's got that little, whatever you call it, where you put the backspin on it and check it up.
I could not wait to see where you were gonna
going
to go with that.
You never know, do you?
I knew the minute you said. I knew where you were headed. I just didn't know how you were going to arrive. Here's Hewitt trying to get to the corner again. Talk about new faces out there on offense. You got some familiar ones out there defensively, but new guys as well. It's Hewitt on that carry and making the stop. Reuben Foster. Talk about young guys with a bright future. How about that young man, one of the top recruits in America a year ago? And Reuben Foster out of Auburn, Alabama, 6'1", 244, making his way to the Crimson Tide. He has progressed nicely. Hasn't played a ton, but again, this is one of the top defenses in America and at a position, Tyler, where it's been in pretty good hands.
Yeah. And he's a guy that's still learning, not the position so much as the system and his responsibilities.
Second and short, Chattanooga converts. As we've got about 4.5 minutes to go here in the quarter. Derek Crane has been a very effective ball carrier for Chattanooga today. Hasn't had a ton of carries, but
been able to get to the edge a couple of times also and pick up chunks of yardage.
They've used him as a receiver once for 17 yards. He's also had 5 carries with not a great average at 2.8, but that's more than anybody else's average for the Mocs today on the ground. Here's Hewitt trying to win that foot race to the corner, and he does. Picks up about 5 or 6 yards, and you will take that all day long.
Pretty good job in the interior, forcing everything outside, and got a couple of hands on him. A little bit of miscommunication up front. The guy's not able to get set. See, Reuben Foster kind of is the one that forced that out, and I probably would have ran outside also.
You know, Tyler, it goes back to what we were talking about with C.J. Mosley earlier. He's got the athletic ability to play with anybody, but he's got the wisdom, the knowledge, the experience to know where he's supposed to be at all moments, and that's what makes him such a great player. And those are things that take time. As good as he was early in his career, he wasn't as good as he is right now.
Right.
He had to learn all of that. He had to go through some growing pains to do it play after play after play. And that Coach Saban talks about this all the time. He goes, you know, the easy inclination is that if a guy's not playing a great deal, that you think he's doing something wrong or that he's not developing properly, when in reality, he could just be behind somebody who's doing it awfully well and doing things the right way so that they stay in the ballgame. Third and short. Robinson able to pick up the first down. Forced to the boundary by Bradley Sill, but again, not until he got past that first down mark.
Jarek Williams there at the line of scrimmage did a good job fighting off the block. Just couldn't quite get off of him, shed him enough to make the tackle. But normally that's when more help will come and you're able to slow the play a little bit, force it to the outside. You'll have a little perimeter help. See Eddie Jackson check in now. So getting a lot of DBs coming in. John Fulton. Excuse me, that's Bradley Silva also. But Eddie Jackson checking in again.
Eddie falls into that same category. Had some time earlier this year, especially the Ole Miss game. Had an interception and big part of that. And Coach Saban asked about it on his radio show this week. He says, look, you know, thing is, it's one thing to play well for a couple of plays, but you've got to do it each possession,
right,
each play. And that's what young guys struggle to learn. But they'll get it. They ultimately do. How about Tanae Patrick? He is
love calling his name.
Yeah, veteran that, well, now that we all, it took a couple years. Everybody was calling him Tana. They couldn't get it right. But Tanae is the right way to pronounce it. But Patrick, senior, had the big forced fumble.
Against LSU.
Looked like they were going to go on the board early in that game. There's a great job by Reuben Foster. Wrapping up Robinson for no gain, maybe a loss on the play. Tell you what, I know the numbers aren't very good, but I've been impressed with Robinson today. He has not done anything in a sense of panic against this Alabama defense. May not have been able to get anything positive, but they haven't had many negative plays based on his decisions.
He hasn't forced the ball in tight windows and turned it over, and that's this type of atmosphere and situation. I think that's about the most that you can ask for him, from him.
Third and 11. They'll dump it off to their tight end. Haven't called his name a lot today, which bugs me because I worked really hard to learn how to say Fessel Shafat. He makes his second catch, setting up fourth down at about 4.
You know, I don't always call out the guy that just carries the ball. You've had plenty of opportunities. He's done a great job blocking.
We'll discuss it during the break. 42-0. The Tide rolling here in Tuscaloosa as we head to the fourth. Alabama leading Chattanooga as we head to the fourth quarter. Let's check in with our Cook's Pest Control sideline reporter, Mick Gillespie.
All right, Chris, remember towards the end of the first half, Ari Quanjo came off the field with an injury. Well, it was a high ankle sprain. He was the last guy out of the clubhouse right at the end of the halftime. But I was told that he probably could play right now with the score and everything else. He's got his helmet off, and he's not going to go back in today. Back to you.
Thank you, Mick. And that is, I say good news. It's not more severe than that, although those high ankle sprains can indeed be a bit of an issue. But
easier for a lineman to deal with that type of pain, though, than a skill guy who's having to cut and everything. So, and they're tough. Those linemen are tough as nails, man.
Those linemen are tough as nails. I don't think we'll get an argument from the gentleman that joins us now in the booth, the athletic director at the University of Alabama, Bill Battle, joining us. Coach, good to see you.
Great to see you, Chris. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you very much. And nice to have you in here when we can relax a little bit in the fourth quarter of a ball game. That's a good thing.
Absolutely. I know everybody worries about fans leaving early, but I don't mind them leaving early if we're 35 ahead.
Would you relay that to the head coach?
No, don't tell him I said that.
Oh, well, I think that was about the same time I asked you if you wanted to be the host of the Nick Saban Show for a certain day, I think, and you passed on that one as well.
Absolutely.
It has been a special season. Bittersweet. You're in this role because of a love for the university and a love for your friend who passed away, the man we all love, Mal Moore, longtime director of athletics. And I know that, again, this is somewhat of a labor of love for you.
Well, there's no question. This is a special place to me and certainly a special time to be here. And the thing that makes me feel good is that I know that Mal is up there with Coach Bryant looking down, and I know he's proud of everything that's going on here.
It's a unbelievable stretch for University of Alabama athletics. You were here at a time with Coach Bryant as a player where it was pretty unbelievable. But now able to witness this and what's taking place now, kind of put it in perspective, if you can, historically, from what you saw then as a player and what you're seeing right now in your role of director of athletics and even before that.
Well, I've got a picture in my office of our 61 team in the stadium, and it was taken in early 62. A team picture in we can see the press box in the background in our stadium, I think seated about 35 or 38,000 people. And what a great time it was then, and now to see the beauty of the campus and the magnitude of the campus. And I think we had 9,000 students. Today we have 34,850 on campus, and in this class this fall there's students from every county in the state, every state in the nation, and 71 foreign countries. So Alabama has become a national and international destination, not only great academics but great athletics, and everything about this place is great right now.
D Hart with the first down pickup as the Tide will keep the drive alive here, leading 42-0. I'm Chris Stewart. Tyler Watts joining me in the booth, and as we said, joined up here now by Alabama's athletic director, Coach Bill Battle. And when you take a look at this particular season, I made the statement, I know a little bit of a step backwards last week in Starkville, but I don't know that I have seen a team improve any more than from week one till about week 10 than this particular Alabama team did.
I was telling Coach Saban earlier this week and told him that I don't know if this was his best coaching job ever, but it very may well be. And I've really enjoyed watching him coach this team. It was a little bit of a struggle early there, but it's a struggle for everybody. You know, you lose all the players that we lost, and you got to replace them with people that don't have the experience. We got a lot of talent. They've recruited well. But it takes time to build chemistry and to do the things that you have to do to compete at this level. But what he and his staff have done over the course of this year, to me, has been remarkable. And I'm really proud and have enjoyed watching them work.
Blake Sims on the delay. And that is a very skilled young man. When he came to Alabama, there was a lot of thought that he would wind up on the defensive side of the football, but he just kept hanging in there, and they had to keep him there on offense, and you see why with a play like that. Coach, when you and I talked, maybe you'd been on the job a month and a half, 2 months perhaps, and you told me I think you'd been in more meetings in that amount of time than you had the previous 25 years. I mean, it's a lot in that role, but I would imagine kind of one of the nice perks is you probably have seen more football practices this year than you've seen in the last 20 years.
I haven't seen as much from standing out on the practice field, but I watch it every day from my office. That's one of the great perks of this job is I've got an office that overlooks the field, and I watch them a little bit every day, and a lot some days, but
ball start.
Some more than others. But it's really neat. The way Coach Saban runs practices is amazing to me. They get as much out of the efficiency of what they get out of practice is remarkable, which is why they play so well, I think. You play like you practice. All coaches say that, but they get more repetitions, and they work on so many different things and prepare the student athletes in so many different ways. It's very impressive.
D. Hart running through a tackler before he's finally pushed out of bounds, and I think that push came after he had gotten to the boundary, so they'll tack on a few more yards and likely will now be a first down. It's been a couple of years or so, we'll say, since you were on the sidelines as a coach. How do you watch a football game now? Through which perspective are you able to watch a game? Can you just relax and enjoy it?
Pretty much, yeah. I can watch and relax and enjoy it. And in this role, I don't get to watch it as closely. I have to watch replays during the week for the most part now. I'll have to admit, I did cheat and watch the LSU game. It was pretty intense. And I didn't do much politicking and working the crowd that day. But most days, I've got other things that I need to be doing, and so I don't get a chance to watch it. But yeah, I watch I watch it like a coach some, but I don't second guess coaches. I didn't like coaches or people second guessing me, and I rarely second guess the coach, but I do enjoy watching talent on both sides. Good close games are great, but for athletic directors, good close games are tough.
Coach Moore used to always tell us some great stories about how he would have a chance here or there to poke his head in during meetings and with the coaches and all. You have a chance to do any of that, and you have to bite your tongue sometimes to prevent that old coach coming out in you.
No, I never bite my tongue. This game is so much more complex and sophisticated than when I was coaching. It's a whole different world. What these guys do is amazing. Although I wouldn't mind seeing a quarterback sneak on third down and a half a yard rather than giving it.
Some things never change, do they?
The backfield, that's right.
Well, that's because you had Condridge, and he was a little bit thicker than A.J., wasn't he?
No, he was a lot smaller than A.J.
Really?
Yeah.
He wasn't as tall, but I was thinking he was a little thicker. Yeah. Condridge will appreciate me saying that anyway, whether he was or not. We're in a spot where, obviously, now I know Coach has got the players focusing on the final 9:25, but it's awfully hard not to look ahead to next week. You've been a part of some memorable Iron Bowls, but can you recall one that really was any bigger in terms of what's at stake for both sides?
I don't think so. I think this is about as big as it gets, and it's a credit to Auburn and Coach Malzahn and what they've done. They've done a remarkable job of taking a team that had pretty good talent, I think. It's obvious that they have good talent, and getting back the confidence and the schemes to just win, to do what it takes to win. It took, early in the year, they came close but found a way to win. And then as the season went on, they've gained confidence. They have gotten better and better every week. It'll be really interesting to me to watch Gus is a great offensive mind, and Coach Saban's a great defensive mind, and it'll be fun to watch how this game plays out.
Alabama Athletic Director Bill Battle, kind enough to join us here in the booth as the Crimson Tide continues its march, leading 42-0. UT Tenpenny on the carry. And he picks up good yardage again. Again, this is a production of the Crimson Tide Sports Network. Crimson Tide pay-per-view coming to you from Bryant-Denny Stadium here in Tuscaloosa. Bama facing third down under the eight-minute mark of this fourth quarter. You mentioned the growth of the university as a whole, the construction that's taken place on the academic side, athletically over the last decade, and the ribbon cut on a new facility and ground set to break very soon on another, as we see the carry there setting up fourth down along the Sarah Patterson Champions Plaza. Obviously a beautiful new addition to the athletic facilities.
It really is. That was an impressive day for me to be a part of that. And that was one of Mal's, I guess, last great visions that that he set in motion. And we dedicated that earlier this fall, and it was a beautiful day with four great coaches, our national championship coaches, not only Sarah Patterson, but Mick Potter, Jay Sewell, and Patrick Murphy. And I told our got a head coaches meeting last couple weeks ago, and I told them one of the building projects that I would love to see is for us to one day expand that Sarah Patterson Champions Plaza. We've got a lot of rooms for national champions, coaches to go on the wall there, but what would be better than to expand that, fill it up, and have to build a bigger one?
Would be awfully nice indeed. Alabama with a 42-0 lead over Chattanooga, 6:55 to go here in the fourth. Telecast is the property of Crimson Tide Sports Marketing, LLC, an affiliate of Learfield Sports, LLC, under rights granted by University of Alabama. Any rebroadcast, retransmission, reproduction, or other dissemination or use of this telecast, or any part of it, without the express written consent of Crimson Tide Sports Marketing, LLC, is prohibited. Chris Stewart, Tyler Watts, Mick Gillespie down on the field, Bama Athletic Director Bill Battle with us for another moment, then we'll let you run here. Coach, we talked about the Champions Plaza, right on the backside of that, Sewell Thomas Stadium, and big announcement, the vote by the Board of Trustees recently that there will be a major overhaul of the baseball facility, and everybody's very excited about that.
We are extremely excited about that. You know, our stadium ranks about 13th in the 14 SEC baseball stadiums, and there had been a lot of work for a few years in redesign and design and several different concepts, but it kind of had taken shape right before I got here in March, and progressed steadily along as we firmed up the final design. And I think we'll have a great stadium. We got to raise some money to build it, but I think that the Tide Nation is anxious to see. They know what great facilities have done for our other sports, and the baseball crowd is really anxious and motivated to help us raise money to get this done. But it will put us up at first or second in the league, and we're all excited about that. We got a good young baseball team. We had a good team last year. They were young. They struggled a little bit at the end, but they made it to the NCAAs. And we had another good recruiting class, and I'm excited about the direction of our whole baseball program. And they're really turned on about this new stadium design.
We all are, Coach, and all excited about athletics as a whole and what lies ahead for the remainder of this athletic and academic year. Thanks so much for the time. It's great to visit with you as always, Coach.
Thanks, Chris. Always good to be here. Appreciate the job you do.
Thank you, sir. Bill Battle, Athletic Director at University of Alabama, joining us here in the booth as we continue in the fourth quarter. The Crimson Tide leading Chattanooga 42-0. And Tyler Watts, this is a program that you were a major part of in the 90s as a player, and had a chance to see you come in here as a signee, then actually play at the university, and now as an alumnus. I know that there's an awful lot of pride by people that have played here at any era for what is taking place, not just with football, but that's certainly where it all starts with Alabama athletics.
Yeah.
But you go down the line, so many good things happening now.
No, absolutely. Think about it. When he first got here, it was probably open ends on both sides. I don't know when they closed it in. I think it was under Bryant that they actually made it a bowl. So he has seen this sucker
pretty much double in size and what it's able to hold. And, you know, the guys that he played with were a big part of that. I mean, the recent history, it all starts back to that signing class and what those guys that Coach Battle and them played, that they all played with, that have kind of kept the ball rolling, so to speak.
Ball is loose. That is a free football. Eddie Jackson's got it. And Eddie Jackson is going to head towards the end zone. And Eddie Jackson is going to get tripped up at the 5-yard line. That ball came squirting free on the inside handoff, and the Crimson Tide will have first and goal from just outside the 5.
I'm not sure who that was there at the left defensive end position, but they are the ones that jarred that ball loose. And talk about helmet on the ball. Watch the right side of your screen. Allen once again. Second time, and that's that little shuffle pass that we've seen over and over and over again, but Allen able to get into the backfield and make a heck of a lick.
That's the reason I think a lot of people hesitated. They knew that it was forward and wondering if that was actually a completed forward pass. If we weren't basically going with a running clock to a degree, then you may. They are going to review this. Yeah, that was something I wondered about. I think they're going to overturn it. I don't know if he actually had possession of the ball before it got knocked loose. There's Alec Morris, who has not taken a snap this year. He redshirted last season. So Alec Morris slated to come in, but Tyler, if that ball is flipped forward, that's what they have to determine. Did the ball carrier actually possess it? Because that is the same as a ball thrown 30 yards downfield.
What's going to make this a challenge is the fact that he had possession.
He had
possession because he made a football move when he turned his shoulders. I think this is going to stand. And that's the safety of that play. But I think that, I mean, the ball was, he was kind of juggling it, but I think that he had enough to make a move with that ball.
And I don't think I've said Jonathan Allen's name, but it was 93 that sent that ball flying, whether it was possessed initially or not. He came in as though he was and delivered the hit to knock it loose. Here's Alec Morris. Talked about getting his first snaps of the year, 6'3", 230 out of Allen, Texas. Yeah, Tyler, I think he did. I think he had it. Not very long.
Chattanooga will be charged with their first time out of the second half.
It happened so fast, and I don't blame if Russ Huseman challenged it. I'm not sure if he did or if they just wanted to see it again from the replay booth. But that is one that when I saw it happen live, I thought it would go as an incomplete pass. But you see the replay, you see why they made the call that they did. So first and goal from just outside the 5. And DeHart, the single setback. The handoff from Morris. Hart will make his way into the end zone. Touchdown, Alabama. Great to see DeHart get a touchdown run, Tyler. He is a young man who's battled a couple of knee injuries earlier in his career. Doesn't have the same role that a lot of people thought he would have when he came to the capstone, but he has been a major performer in special teams and a guy who you see is still more than capable when he's handed the pigskin.
And you see everybody running out there to congratulate him as a result of it, too.
Popular young man is, and he has shown a lot of courage through his career. Here's Adam Griffith on to try the extra point. Griffith knocking that one through, as he is now 5 of 5 on PATs this year. DeHart getting the touchdown carry, and the Crimson Tide adds to its lead. Now 49-0 over Chattanooga late in the fourth. 5 minutes remaining here in the fourth quarter. Very chilly Bryant Denny Stadium, but the Crimson Tide red hot today. 49-0 after a little bit of a shaky start early in the first quarter, Tyler. This team, both offensively and defensively, has handled their business very, very well.
This is a team that kind of has set a standard of a little slow out of the chute, figures things out relatively quickly, and then in the second half they'll just squeeze you to death. And today's been no different. Both sides of the football, moving the ball offensively, but just really tightened down on that defensive side.
Our colleague Phil Savage handles the color on the Crimson Tide Sports Network radio broadcast, talks about Bama being like a boa constrictor. They just continue to squeeze and squeeze, as you said, and before you know it, the life is gone. That is what they were hoping to see today as they look towards next week and a matchup that will determine the SEC Western Division champion. Bama assured of at least a share, but that won't mean nearly as much. They want this thing outright. They want to stay perfect. They want to go to Atlanta and then hopefully from there to Pasadena.
It's going to be a tough challenge next week also, because you're facing an opponent that starts off so quick. And the fact that you struggle, it could be an interesting matchup there.
Taking a look at the SEC scoreboard, Mississippi State in overtime, able to knock off the Arkansas Razorbacks. South Carolina, no problem with Coastal Carolina, but how about that one down in Gainesville? Florida trailing Georgia Southern by a score of 20-10. Boy, the Eagles that we saw a couple of years ago can indeed get after you, and a struggling Florida team down 10 at home, third quarter of that one. Saw the other matchup, Texas A&M LSU, early in that contest. Our game in the late stages, final 5 minutes and 7 seconds is Griffith's kick. Bit of a squibber that Green bobbles, loses the handle completely. Ball on the deck, and who's got it? Bama says they do, but they were wrong. It's Chattanooga's football. Marquise Green was down there trying to find a handle to it and just couldn't. Oh, Kurt Freitag thought he had it.
Well, he did.
I said it was Freitag. I was wrong. Excuse me. Our apologies. It's a young man that we don't have on our initial roster, but great job by our spotters here. Jared Bierbauer,
5-yard penalty, still first down,
able to get close but couldn't quite come up with it. So
you'd never make it without help.
You're just now figuring that out. But I gotta look for help to my left because it ain't coming
it ain't
from my right
from me.
On the handoff, I believe that is Crane on the carry. And again, I know this is a 49-point ball game right now, but these guys from Chattanooga do not have to leave here with their heads down. They have played very solid football today, and you can see why they were among the best in the Southern Conference. And again, by the end of today, could be the outright Southern Conference champions. And if they're able to get all their guys back healthy a week from now, should they be called on to play in the FCS playoffs, it's not a matchup that many teams would welcome. Had a very good season. And Terrell Robinson has done a solid job, if not spectacular, against this Alabama defense. But again, the 49-0 lead doesn't have anything to do with Chattanooga's miscues. This is basically Alabama playing well.
Yeah, especially here in the second half, and that's really where the point differential really spread out there. And I think you're right. I think Chattanooga can take a lot away from this game, a lot of positives and moving the football and having scoring opportunities and just coming up a little short. But as you mentioned, nothing to hang your head about.
Third and a yard. To give to Crane, and he's going to get the first down, I believe. Yes, he will, near the 30. So the clock will continue to run. Nick Saban has a 24-hour rule where he allows players to enjoy a victory before they move on to the next opponent. He may have to enforce the 24-hour rule to make them enjoy this for 24 hours.
Yeah.
I think the minds have already turned towards the Plains.
I hope so.
I would be shocked if they haven't. Great turnaround for the Tigers this year. Alabama will come in ranked number one of the country against the currently sixth-ranked Tigers. As boy, he had two guys colliding there. Fortunate they're able to get up. It was Reuben Foster and I believe Reggie Ragland that may have collided on that play. So often you see two defenders going after a ball carrier, they collide, and it is bad, bad news for one of them, but those two young men appear to be okay. Foster again in the backfield making the stop. Tim Williams there as well. You got to play a lot of guys. You've played well as long as you don't lose anybody that we may have missed injury-wise. This has been about as good as you could hope for.
Yeah, I mean, you got the win and able to still work on some things. That slow start, that's the fourth time I've gone back to it. I just don't like to see it. But I like how once that second quarter gets rolling, so does that offense.
When you can fail to find a handful of games in the course of the year where your team has not played at a pretty high level, and you're at week 11 and there are no losses.
Yeah.
It's pretty good.
We're nitpicking.
We are. But that's
at that point, but
that's basically where Nick Saban has set his standard and what he expects of the players. And it's gotten to the point that fans and media have come to expect that from his teams as well. Again, the rugby-style punt from Nick Pollard. And it rolls dead at the 13-yard line. So Alabama will have it first and 10 from there. Final 31 seconds of the ball game. As A.J. McCarron and Kenny Bell, two good friends, enjoy their final moments here at Bryant-Denny. As loud as 2 weeks ago when Dixieland Delight was struck up here at Bryant-Denny Stadium, but enjoyed by those that are still left nonetheless. We welcome you back for the final 31 seconds of this one. Alabama and Chattanooga just about done. And Alabama set to go 11-0 on the year. Chattanooga will fall to 8-4 and then find out their fate. As far as the playoffs are concerned, Mick Gillespie, it has been a good ball game for the Tide today.
It has been a great game, Chris. And, you know, you got 15 seniors. Seven of them are fifth-year seniors. They have a chance, and the schedule really heats up with the Iron Bowl next week, to leave college with four national championship rings. Boy, that would really be something, Chris. I tell you, that would be an accomplishment that has been unmatched in college football.
No question. And we think about the modern history. Nobody has won three in a row. And it was a week ago. He may have mentioned it earlier, but I had not heard it. Nick Saban used the H word. He said history in referencing what these guys have a chance to be a part of, because some of them are brand new players. Other guys were a part of basically when this began and the championship run got started. But that's why next Saturday afternoon at Jordan-Hare Stadium will indeed be so big.
It's pretty cool when you put it that way.
Kind of hit me there as well.
Definitely a different Auburn team than what we've seen the last 2 years, though. And that's, but I almost think that plays to our advantage, Chris, because I think the guys are going to be focused, ready to play this game, aren't going to be nervous because they've been in these type of environments and situations before. I think it'll bring out the best in us also.
Final snap of the ball game. Alabama now 11-0, 49-0. Your final score, the Crimson Tide, a win. Chattanooga earning even more respect from head coach Nick Saban and his Alabama players as the Mocs played very solid and capped a great regular season. But for Alabama, one more game to go before their regular season comes to a close. We come back to wrap things up after this here on Crimson Tide Pay-Per-View. Fifteen seniors heading back through the tunnel for their final time as Crimson Tide football players here at Bryant-Denny Stadium. Tyler Watts, a great way to go out.
Not bad, and it was fun watching a couple of the seniors there, as you mentioned, taking that victory lap, showing their appreciation to the fans, and it being reciprocated there, and that's pretty cool right there.
It is indeed. Ari Quanjo, not a senior, but good to see him walking rather well, going off the field, and great to see the Tide roll to its 11th victory of the season. A.J. McCarron and some of his fellow seniors basically taking a victory lap here at Bryant-Denny, getting a chance to say goodbye to many of the fans here. Those four or five guys, part of a tremendous senior class, it still has a little bit of work to be done. But today, they took care of business. On senior day, the Tide rolls to a 49-0 victory over the Chattanooga Mocs. For Tyler Watts, Mick Gillespie, and our entire Crimson Tide pay-per-view crew, I'm Chris Stewart. Thanks for joining us. Roll Tide, and so long from the Capstone.